Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It is with great, great pleasure that I welcome you all from all over the world to the first public event of Documenta 15, the first episode of a series of conversation titled Lumbung Calling. My name is Mirwan Andan, but you can call me Andan, and I'm from Onrupa, a collective based in Jakarta, Indonesia. And I'm sitting here in Makassar, South Sulawesi. We have been invited to be the artistic director of Documenta 15. Documenta 15 will be open on June 18, 2022. But various events and programs have already been initiated. Lumbung Calling, as mentioned, is the very first event of our public program, which we call Maidan. Lumbung Calling consists of a series of conversations with a variety of guests focused on exploring the rich meaning of Lumbung across multiple disciplines, angles, points of view, and context. First of all, let me explain what Lumbung is, as Lumbung is at the very core of Documenta 15. Lumbung is defined as a container to store agricultural products, commonly rice, in the form of a house on stilts with walls of woven wood or bamboo. It is an easily recognizable building in Indonesia, similar to a barn. However, Lumbung goes beyond its physicality, and it is used to describe shared collective resources. It can be seen also as a set of values and a cosmology that describes the common living, the common sharing, as a possible practice of a society. It is evidence of a communal life marked by the spirit of collaboration, and this characteristic can be tracked back to pre-modern and pre-colonial societies. Here, Lumbung means a hardware and also at the same time, a software. Lumbung Calling, the name of this program, is a calling to the world, to our deepest social attitudes we all share. And it is meant to raise awareness on the practice of sharing the Lumbung practice. Each edition of this series is dedicated to one of the Lumbung values. The present one is dedicated to local anchor. And the next ones will be humor, generosity, independence, transparency, sufficiency, and regeneration. The invited protagonists have faced major challenges and initiated true changes on various scales: academics, cultural activists, independent researchers, organic farmers, and festival organizers, among others. Lumbung Calling will take place on the first Saturday of every month over 7 sessions. From now on, this April, until October 2021. The conversation itself will last around an hour, followed by a short break, and we will resume with questions and the public. In the YouTube chat, it is indeed possible to ask questions or write comments that will be selected and shared with our guests. Please note that this event will stay online afterwards. I couldn't have wished for a more perfect co-host, the artist Jumana Emil Abud, who is currently sitting in Jerusalem. Jumana's creative interest sits in oral histories, personal and collective stories and mythologies, particularly folk tales and their sides of being and unbeing. She uses storytelling, performative elements, and workshop methodologies in her artistic practice to investigate our relation to time and place, to the human, and of course, the non-human. Her work has been shown at many institutions and biennial around the globe, among which the Baltic Center for Contemporary Art in England, Sharjah Biennale, Istanbul Biennale, and Venice Biennale. Jumana Emil Abud is currently pursuing a practice-led PhD at the Slade School of Fine Art, University College, London. Without further ado, I will give the word to Jumana, who will introduce further local anchor, Melani Budianta and Armin Salasa. Jumana, it's yours.
Thank you so much. Thank you for a wonderful introduction. I'm super delighted to be with you, with our esteemed speakers today, and with you, Andan, and with everyone. Now, before I introduce our wonderful speakers, I'm going to just tell you briefly about what is meant by the local anchor, which is the topic for today's Lumbung Calling. The metaphor of an anchor describes the value of soil in our globalized yet divided world, soil that enables roots to grow and connects trees located miles and miles apart. Just as trees echo each other's signals, harvesting and cultivation methods can resonate with and be amplified by local wisdoms, bringing to life new resources and developing diverse relationships with time. Our guests, Melanie Budianta and Armin Salasa, examine ways of challenging integrated models of political, social, and economic behaviors in discussions unfurling from the point of view of a seed to the tender voices of concerned mothers. Melanie Budianta is a professor of literature and cultural studies in the Faculty of Humanities at the University of Indonesia and is a member of the Inter-Asia Cultural Studies Society. Since the late 1980s, Budianta has undertaken research and writing focused on gender and cultural activism. Her articles have been published in academic journals, newspapers, and magazines. During the Asian financial crisis of 1997 and 1998, she participated in Indonesia's women's movement. In 2020, Melana Budianta presented her talk, Lumbung Budaya Sepanjanggang, or Cultural Granaries Along the Alleys, organized by the Jakarta Arts Council. Our second speaker, Armin Salasa, is a farmer and an activist in Bulukumba, South Sulawesi, Indonesia. In 2011, Salasa, along with farmers from the village where he was born, began implementing natural farming, an organic practice that's long existed in many other areas of the archipelago. Natural farming techniques combine scientific knowledge with wisdom, stories, and practices inherited from ancestors, removing the need for chemical fertilizers, pesticides, herbicides, etc. Since 1993, he has worked as a community organizer in various locations throughout Indonesia and advocated for the denied rights of indigenous people in Palu, Central Sulawesi. Since 2007, Armin Salasa has assisted community organizations in numerous Indonesian villages, including Aceh, Sumatra, following the 2004 tsunami. And now, without further ado, we welcome Melanie Budianta. It's all yours, Melanie.
Thank you for your beautiful introduction, Jumana. I'm much honored to be invited to this launch of the Lumbung Calling Project by Documenta with Ruang Rupa as a director, arts director. The project pretty much overlaps with my interest and my cultural activism in the past 4 years. Lumbung, as a granary for the storage of rice harvest, is known all over Indonesia and is called by different ethnic languages. You see a few only there in the map, but we have over 700 languages altogether. The Lumbung has different shapes according to each region, but with similar architectural pattern of steep roof with loft or space within it, the central storage area, and the hollow space under the Lumbung. In many rural areas, there are individual Lumbungs in each house, as well as the collective village Lumbung. In today's world, with urban expansion and land grabbing for extractive and consumptive industries, Lumbungs are disappearing. However, in my various grassroots activism, be it in the urban peripheries or in rural villages, I found how the symbol of Lumbung is still widely used by many organizations. In fact, the Lumbung becomes a symbol of an effort in gathering collective memory and cultural resources, tangible as well as intangible, for the common benefit of the people. As each kampung tries to construct their identity, they start by identifying what are available in the community. It can be old people who knows history of the community, or a kampung dweller with knowledge about traditional music, dance, herbal medicine, urban farming, or alternative healing, or culinary practice, like grandma's recipe, for example. And they try to construct a space and some ways for storing the knowledge. It can be digital websites, it can be book, it can be a small corner in the village, and they create a small museum for display. Right. But actually the whole kampung serves as a space for the lumbung. And as the kampung become the collective space, it is very important for the community to create a livable and comfortable kampung environment as their home. Sometimes they use unused lot for children's playground. Sometimes they painted the walls of their alleys to create a beautiful space around them. And next, there is this value of regeneration, of finding a system to reactivate, revive, and to develop the cultural resources for the young people. They set up workshop for youth or create a space for performance. In some of the kampungs that I visited, the older traditional recipes of the mother or grandmother can be packaged in a millennial style of menus. And they created this kampung style cafes where young people in the village can learn to do business. So they mix the old with the new, right? There is also an important value of organizing the sustainability and distribution of the lumbung benefits for economic or social well-being. They organize who should do what and how people share the benefit. Here lies also the value of transparency and democratic participatory process of working together, which in Indonesia we call gotong royong. This is a very well-known term that almost all Indonesians know, that it is a collective spirit of working together and sharing together. An example of this is the urban farming initiative done by the kampung community, especially during the pandemic. In this kind of activity, they put up schedule chart in the alleys to remind people who should be in charge of what and when. The collective together is heightened, especially during the pandemic, whereby the urban kampung dwellers in the city, but in the peripheries, they try to revive again their older tradition called jimpitan, which is to chip in a cup of rice daily from each household in order to be collected together and later on distributed for those who need it in the time of crisis. Yeah, so this is also a kind of food security, which is similar to the lumbung practice in the rural villages. Although this collective initiative are locally anchored in different communities all over Indonesia, what I find interesting in the past 4 or 5 years is that these kampung started to connect with each other through a digital social media platform and created a larger lumbung network. One WhatsApp group can consist of up to 150 urban and rural village communities, which do a larger collective activities, sometimes by visiting one village and another in order to share experience and support each other's cultural activities. Sometimes, especially, they do it during Kampung festivals, right? And they visit and they share, they meet and they chat with one another. The overall atmosphere of the WhatsApp group as well as the offline meeting is usually light, full of light humor and festivity and fun. By becoming a member of this informal WhatsApp group of Jaringan Kampung Nusantara or Nusantara Kampung Network, I managed to know stories of several kampungs which I would like to share now. The first is the Kampung Cempluk. Kampung Cempluk was initially a rural village which was swallowed by the urban expansion. So it became an urban kampung surrounded by gentrified urban middle class environment. They were in danger of being evicted through land grabbing as the price of land increased. In order to save and return their neighborhood and their community, the residents invent annual Kampung Festival. The name of Cemplo means kerosene lamp, and during that festival, they turn off electricity and used kerosene lamp only to remember the past. And then they shared traditional snack, performed traditional dances and songs that they remembered. The festivals finally put the village in the city map. Thus, the branding of the Kampung identity helped them to save their existence. Second is a Kampung Karanggreneng, a kind of urbanized rural village near Yogyakarta. It was a very poor sub-village. 40% of the existing household were aging widows who work as farm workers, as nut grinders with monthly income less than $100. The village had no special natural or cultural attraction and was high in urban consumption and low in social cohesion. But then one villager was inspired by a TV show called If I Were This and I Were That. And he created a collective live-in project for Jakarta youth to experience rural living. In the beginning, nobody took him seriously, but then he started to, you know, to convince others. And finally, they managed to organize villagers to recall and relearn traditional games, dance, gamelan music. And they started to identify local villagers who can remember these things and can teach the youth their traditional culture. They shared the collective income of the program to build common space for village traditional art. Since then, the spirit of Gotong Royong and working for collective benefit for all is reinstalled in the village. Now, there are many similar efforts like that. For example, a village in East Java called Ledokombo, half of the population went as migrant workers to Asian countries, leaving the left behind children to be taken care by the elderly. This condition changed when there is a couple of cultural activists from Jakarta returning home to the village and set up a library and playground for children, and then started to revive the traditional children game called Egrang or bamboo stilt game. The couple used their network to support the village activities and created annual festival. Now the children were invited all internationally to do the stilt dance, and the Kampung organization later on created school for mothers and for grandparents to equip them with lifelong learning, how to regain knowledge of planting organic herbal gardens, turning them into herbal medicine and drinks. In that way, returning migrants now can find means for living in the village. As we all know, during the pandemic, about 80% of migrant workers abroad were returned to their village. Now, these examples show how the Kampung cultural commoning or lumbung activity reverse the currents of today's hyper-urbanization. Collectively, they try to save the green environment in their village and construct a livable, economically viable, and culturally satisfying home in the urban or rural villages for the future generation. Thank you. Jumana.
so much, Melanie. Thank you. It's wonderful to hear about your experiences. And I'm very curious to know more, and we'll get to that, I think, when we have a chance to ask questions. But for now, I'm really interested as well to hear and to note the link between you and Armin. And this will be the moment where I hand the microphone to Armin. If you could please share with us your experience towards the collective efforts that you have done. The microphone is yours. Thank you.
Baik, terima kasih atas kesempatan kepada saya, dan saya merasa senang bergabung di panggung ini, bergabung bersama kita semua. Pertama, saya akan menjelaskan soal Salasai. Salasai ini adalah satu desa pertanian yang terletak di Kabupaten Bulukumba, persisnya itu di bagian utara kabupaten, dan letaknya kurang lebih 180 km dari kota Makassar, kota provinsi Sulawesi Selatan. Nah, keluarga tani di sini menggunakan sistem pertanian campur, di mana para petani itu menanam berbagai macam jenis tanaman, ada durian, ada cengkeh, coklat, merica atau lada, dan pisang di satu kawasan di lahan pertaniannya. Dan Salasai sendiri adalah dalam bahasa Bugis, berasal dari kata bahasa Bugis Tua yang berarti istana. Memang pada saat ini sudah tidak ada istana, tetapi tertinggal hanya situs tempat pelantikan raja-raja kecil dulu yang ada di wilayah sini, sebagai satu tanda bahwa ini adalah satu wilayah di mana sebagai desa kami di Salasai.
So thank you very much for inviting us. It's an honor for me to be here to joining all of you. First of all, let me begin the explanation from Salasa. So Salasa itself is located in Bulukumba district, around 180 kilometers from Makassar, capital of the province. And most of the farmers in Salasa have various types of plants cultivated on their soil, such as durian, banana, cacao, and so on. And the name of the Salasa itself comes from the ancient Bugis language, which means palace. Well, the palace itself is no longer exist, but only the sites of once a site for coronation for king and queens existed in the area.
Tempat penyimpanan hasil panen di masa lampau itu disebut dengan lumbung dalam bahasa Indonesia. Tetapi kami orang-orang Salasai itu punya penamaan sendiri, namanya adalah PAR, P-A-R-A. Secara fisik ia adalah tempat untuk menyimpan hasil panen, baik padi, jagung maupun hasil lainnya. Dan secara posisi yang ditempatkan di bagian atas rumah dan di bawah atap, itu adalah sebagai bukti bahwa orang-orang Salasai atau orang-orang yang menggunakan PAR itu adalah tempat untuk sebagai bukti pemujaan kepada Ilahi, kepada Tuhan yang senantiasa memberikan nikmat pangan yang tersedia sepanjang waktu. Dan dari segi proses sebenarnya para dari sisi proses, dia menunjukkan perjalanan dari benih hingga sampai makanan sampai di atas para itu. Dalam proses ini juga kita mengetahui bahwa ada proses di mana peran perempuan di dalam pembenihan, kemudian ada peran bersama ketika proses pemeliharaan, menanam dan memelihara hingga pada panen, di mana pada saat panen itu orang-orang berkesempatan untuk mengambil bagian, berperan, lalu kemudian mengambil bagian dari hasil panen.
So Salasai has its own term to name a practice or space to store crops such as rice, which in Indonesian language called lumbung, people in Salasai used to call it para. Physically speaking, para is a space to store crops such as rice, corn, and so on. And cosmologically speaking, para that is located in between the ceiling and roof inside the house where the rock is stored illustrates a lofty attitude towards the food. It's a manifestation of gratitude to God who provides the food all the time. And speaking of the process of para itself, para is a metaphor for the cycle
from sowing the seed to eat the food, and it involves many roles, like roles of women, roles of children, and so on. Whenever the harvesting seasons arise, all people have the opportunity to work and share the yields.
Nah, tentang para kemudian mendapatkan ujian pada saat revolusi hijau dimulai, yaitu ketika di awal kekuasaan kekuasaan otoritarian Orde Baru yang pernah berkuasa selama 30 tahun lebih. Nah, dalam proses ini revolusi hijau merupakan kendaraan atau tumpangan bagi industri yang digunakan, dia menggunakan alat negara baik sipil maupun militer, kemudian masuk di kampung-kampung terutama di wilayah pedesaan, yang menjanjikan apa yang disebut dengan hasil panen yang lebih baik, tapi kemudian yang terjadi adalah penghancuran penghancuran nilai-nilai lokal, pengetahuan, dan sampai pada pada benih. Dan apa yang terjadi, termasuk terjadi di salah saya, adalah bahwa kemudian tanah-tanah menjadi kurus, orang-orang tersingkir dari kehidupannya dalam kurun waktu kurang lebih 30 tahun terakhir. Ketika kami belum memulai bersama dengan teman-teman di Salasai, lebih dari 1000 orang-orang Salasai itu menyingkir, meninggalkan kampung halaman untuk pergi di tempat-tempat lain, mencari penghidupan yang lebih baik daripada dunia pertanian yang rusak itu. Mereka ada yang ke Malaysia, ada yang ke kota-kota besar lainnya yang ada di Indonesia ini.
So, during the Green Revolution, which was imposed by the new orders, who ruled Indonesia for 32 years, the cultural system of para was under a constant threat. So Green Revolution was used as a vehicle for chemical industry to take advantages from the village. And Green Revolution also introduced the uses of chemicals in farming, which prioritized the maximal production. It is in turn segregates the main culture of people in Salasai, and the land becomes exhausted, and people were migrated to other places such as Malaysia to work to work in a plantation companies that in Malaysia and other places in Sulawesi.
Nah, pada tahun 2011 ya, belasan orang sampai 20 orang petani dari Salasai, artinya orang-orang yang pernah keluar meninggalkan kampung itu, kembali lalu kemudian melakukan refleksi, memungut ingatan, menggali ingatan, menggali pengetahuan kembali, kemudian mereka memilih untuk melakukan aksi apa yang disebut dengan pertanian alami. Dan yang pasti adalah bahwa orang-orang Salasai menganggap desanya itu adalah sesuatu yang sama pentingnya dengan kampung-kampung lain. Mereka menganggap bahwa Salasai sama pentingnya dengan Jakarta, Washington, maupun Berlin sendiri. Kemudian kami membangun apa yang disebut dengan proses belajar bersama dengan teman-teman untuk apa yang disebut dengan pertanian alami.
So in 2011, around 20 people of former plantation workers came back to Salasai. So working in rubber area or oil palm plantations didn't seem to have significant impacts on their lives. So the farmers in Salasai, the former plantation workers in Salasai came to reflect, to rediscover the memories of the past, which then came to the conclusion to the application of natural farming. And then another reflection came to the farmers, was that Salasai should be regarded as an important place, as important as any other places like New York, Jakarta, or Berlin. And it is also from this process that farmers began to appreciate the process of learning.
Jadi orang-orang Salasai merasa perlu untuk membangun kembali kebanggaannya sebagai orang desa. Dan melalui pertanian alami ini, kami memulai semacam menjadi arus balik ke nilai-nilai lokal yang terancam punah. Nah, apa yang disebut pertanian alami, dia bukan hal teknis semata. Dia sebuah prinsip di mana ingin memastikan bahwa orang-orang yang bertanian alami itu turut berkembang bersama dengan pengembangan tanaman, pengembangan tanah, dan lain-lain. Dan yang pasti lagi, bahwa pada praktiknya, pertanian alami benar-benar mengandalkan tenaga alam. Tenaga alam, sumber daya alam yang ada di lokal, bagaimana menciptakan nutrisi untuk menyuburkan tanah maupun nutrisi untuk menyuburkan tanaman itu yang bersumber dari bahan-bahan yang ada di lingkungan kami di Salasae. Dan satu lagi, dan ternyata dalam proses ini tidak butuh waktu yang lama sehingga kemudian memberi dampak baik terhadap peningkatan pemahaman petani sendiri, dampak ekonomi, kemudian pemulihan lahan-lahan pertanian.
So the idea is to create a sense of pride to live and being on Salasae people. It's also to reverse the idea of green revolution to come back to the local values that we have. So nature of farming is not just a matter of technicality, but it's also a principle to develop together with the nature, which is relying on the natural resources to create the nutrition necessary to enrich the soil, which is also coming from the area around Salasae itself. Afterwards, the effect is so good. The effect is so so good. So many people got their benefits in terms of the economy and also refresh the healthy of the soil and so on.
Nah, dampak baik daripada pertanian alam ini juga menjadi refleksi kami dan teman-teman di Salasae ternyata bahwa masalah yang ditimbulkan oleh revolusi hijau itu tidak hanya terjadi di Salasae, tetapi juga terjadi di desa-desa lain di hampir seluruh Indonesia dan terutama di sekitar kita. Sehingga kemudian muncullah apa yang disebut keinginan untuk menyebarluaskan kabar gembira ini, kegembiraan untuk bertani alami maupun berorganisasi.
So along the way, the natural farming community in Salasae realized that the chemical farming resulted from green revolution has devastating impacts on other villages across Indonesia. So, driven by such reflection, the need to disseminate natural farming practices and knowledge to the other farmers was reached, which then pathway for the establishment of Salasae as collective sufficient rural community.
Nah, kesadaran ini menjadi titik awal dari pembangunan organisasi yang kami sebut dengan Komunitas Bina Pedesaan Salasae atau Komunitas Salasae. Nah, organisasi ini menjadi rumah gerakan bersama untuk satu, membangun pemahaman kita sendiri, teman-teman petani-petani Salasae, maupun bertindak sebagai gerbong, sebagai alat untuk menyebarluaskan gagasan membangun nilai lokal, menggali nilai lokal, maupun menyebarkan praktek pertanian alami.
So the this organization, the aim of this organization is to build the understanding of people about natural farming, and it's also used as an action, as a call to action, to disseminate the idea of natural farming to the other people. And
Nah, masalah yang kita hadapi kemudian adalah bahwa kebanyakan dari kami adalah orang-orang yang tidak memiliki pengalaman organisasi, tidak memiliki pengalaman untuk melatih dan lain-lain. Tetapi itu tidak pernah menjadi halangan untuk kemudian menghalangi kita bekerja, menyebarluaskan gagasan, ide maupun hasrat untuk membangun masa depan yang lebih baik. Nah, teman-teman kemudian membangun kemampuannya di dalam berorganisasi, dalam berbicara maupun di dalam mengajar sehingga kemudian bisa atau memungkinkan kami menyebarluaskan apa yang disebut dengan gerakan pertanian alami ini.
So there was a problem when the first time we initiated the organization. The farmers didn't have organization skills, but it didn't become a problem for us to spread the idea of natural farming, to build a better future and to learn. So at first, we learned how to speak, how to teach, how to be involved in the dialogue and conversation and so on.
Nah, dalam seluruh proses yang terjadi di Salasae dari dulu maupun hingga sekarang ini, peran terpenting adalah peran perempuan Salasae. Peran perempuan Salasae ini itu ada hampir di seluruh sektor kehidupan masyarakat, terutama di kebudayaan para. Mereka terlibat dalam praktik mulai dari pembenihan, menanam, memelihara, sampai kemudian panen. Tapi inti utama daripada peran Salasae adalah dia menjadi ujung tombak atau penentu ketahanan pangan atau kedaulatan pangan daripada masyarakat desa. Mereka yang paling menentukan kapan bahan-bahan makanan itu atau baik benih maupun hasil panen lainnya itu dijual atau tidak, itu terutama ditentukan oleh kelompok perempuan ini atau masyarakat-masyarakat yang perempuan ini yang menentukan keseluruhan itu.
So women has also important role in all sectors in the culture of Para in Bulukumba, from breed the seed, cultivate the soil, cultivate the plants, and to harvest the yields itself. It is also the role of women who determine the food sovereignty, whether it should be sold or not. It's all on the decision from our women.
Nah, dalam diskusi kami teman-teman soal apa nilai Para sebenarnya. Nilai Para ini ada pada titik satu, mulai dari ia lahir hingga mati, dan yang paling titik rendah adalah soal kepasrahan maupun menyadari atau menerima keadaan diri apa adanya, sampai di puncak tertinggi itu mengakui keberadaan ilahi sebagai yang menciptakan secara keseluruhan. Nah, dalam proses itu, dalam titik tengahnya, dalam prosesnya, kebudayaan Para kemudian diterjemahkan dalam musyawarah dan gotong royong, perenungan dan pemujaan. Bagaimana dalam perenungan menerima apa adanya diri sendiri, kemudian memuja kepada yang Maha Kuasa. Dan seluruh energi yang digerakkan adalah energi musyawarah dan gotong royong.
So Para values is also the process of Para value can also be from the birth until death. So it is the value that we have to be submissive to recognize the existence of God. The system of Para itself is translated into collective actions from assembly to working collectively to build facilities and so on, and also to be able to pray for the God and to be grateful to God and so on.
Nah, dari semua yang disampaikan tadi, kami berharap bahwa di masa depan saya bisa menjadi rumah belajar bersama, tidak saja orang-orang salah saya, tetapi siapa saja yang mau terlibat untuk menjadikan salah saya menjadi tempat, menjadi laboratorium bersama, menjadi tempat belajar bersama untuk menggali nilai-nilai baik yang ada di salah saya maupun di tempat-tempat lain. Kami berharap bahwa seluruh sisi salah saya yang luasnya 10,08 km bisa menjadi ruang kelas bagi siapapun, bisa menjadi tempat belajar bagi siapapun.
So in the future, we hope that the Salasai can be a space for learning for everybody. It can be a collective laboratorium for everybody to rediscover the value, also to practice the natural farming. We also hope that every corner of Salasai, which is around 10 kilometers, can be a classroom for everybody to learn anywhere in every corner of Salasai. Thank you very much.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Amin and Harry. Thank you. And so that I don't forget to remind our listeners today, from wherever you're listening across the world, I want to remind you that you can post your questions that you have for Melanie and Armin in the YouTube channel, and we'll be able to select, both myself and Andan can select from there and share your questions with our speakers. Wow, there's so much that's resonating with me from hearing you both speak. The whole idea of Lumbung and the local anchor and your distinctive experiences of the main value of what is Lumbung. And some of the words that are resonating with me are the Para, the idea of the Para, and the idea of the Gotengroyo, I hope I'm pronouncing them right, this idea of the collective working, right? The idea of a collective gathering and collective efforts, and the notion of the collective effort of not just being something which is collective among humans, but also collective with nature. And one of the first questions I'm really keen to ask you both is connected with this idea of value. And maybe if I can ask you first, Melanie, to share with us through your Lumbung experience about values And then I will also ask Armin to talk about a little bit about that too.
Yes, you mentioned it very much right. The Gotong Royong, I think, is central to this collaborative, collective working together. Yeah. However, sometimes we get the idea that the collective could be repressive to individual difference. So I would like to share with you that this is not what we want to have in this kampung commoning or gotong royong in the lumbung spirit. Yeah. Instead, we would like the spirit to be bottom up. It should be a democratic decision making, just like what Pak Amin already shared with you, how women and men, you know, they negotiate, they decide what to do collectively, and the decision making should be inclusive to all, empowering women, the marginalized, and the minorities within their community. So that is one thing that is very important, the bottom-up and participative kind of decision-making. Another value is, of course, transparency in managing the collective spirit. I show you pictures of how people, you know, put schedules of work, and this is negotiated, and the work is shared as well as the benefits that they get from the collective activity. So how to manage the lumbung together, how to organize it. Amrin already said that some of the kampung are not very experienced in doing organization, but they learn by listening to others, by working together, inviting people who knows to how to do this and that. Next is the value of transferring knowledge, especially the cultural knowledge, the cultural memory for the young people. And also to transfer leadership for future regeneration. So it is, I think, some of the values that are important. But the last but not least is happiness of being together. I think happiness, humor, festivity is very important for Indonesian. Without this, the collective lumbung gathering would not work. Whenever people come together, there is always food, there is always laughter, always arts, dance, music. So these are all integrated into the collective effort. Of course, I have to say that each kampung is locally anchored, so they have local differences. The ones that Pak Amrin Salasat talks about and the one that I talk about, or the one in East Indonesian islands, for example, they each have their own locally anchored knowledge and tradition. But I think some of the values that I talk is shared amongst all. Thank you, Jumana. I hope this answers you a little bit.
Yes, yes, absolutely. It's amazing. I mean, it's amazing to hear about both the individual's needs and how their voices, the individual's voices, are heard within the collective. And the learning, I mean, the learning process, I've always felt the learning process, you know, is the more that it's a collective organization, the better the learning. So I'm, you know, I'm also curious to hear more about the learning process from Armin through his experience over 15 years with the farmers. So Armin, I'd like here to direct a question to you now with regards to values. And in an earlier conversation, we had you had briefly mentioned about how being uprooted from culture can impact on values. I'm wondering if you can share with us today a little more about this.
Yeah, apa namanya, kalau nilai lokal tidak menjadi bagian daripada proses di komunitas, sebagaimana kita tahu bahwa terutama di desa, komunitas itu terbentuk dari paling tidak empat hal. Pertama, pemerintah, masyarakat, nilai itu sendiri, dan juga sumber daya alamnya. Jika tanpa kearifan lokal, maka relasi maupun peran di antara mereka ini kemudian bisa berubah. Satu, pemerintah bisa menjadi robot saja. Yang kedua, masyarakat juga bisa menjadi robot saja. Yang ketiga, maka nilai-nilai yang berkuasa di masyarakat hanya uang saja. Dan yang keempat adalah sumber daya alam hanya akan dipandang sebagai sumber untuk dilakukan eksploitasi. Jadi tidak ada nilai sama sekali. Nah, sehingga kemudian seperti kita tahu bahwa kalau berdasarkan kebijakan saja atau aturan-aturan pemerintahan, kita tahu bahwa aturan-aturan pemerintahan lebih banyak didominasi untuk kepentingan kekuasaan, sehingga kemudian dia tidak bisa dipercaya 100% untuk menjamin keberlangsungan daripada sebuah masyarakat. Dia harus berangkat dari nilai lokal yang berbeda. Satu lagi yang saya mau tambahkan bahwa hampir seluruh nilai lokal itu tergantung berada di atas tanah. Maksudnya adalah dia tergantung pada tanahnya. Nilai lokal dari satu tempat ke tempat lain itu tergantung dengan ragam tumbuhan, ragam hewan maupun ragam perilaku yang ada di satu wilayah dan wilayah tertentu. Sehingga kami menyadari bahwa kerusakan terhadap sumber daya alam, kerusakan terhadap tanah itu sama dengan awal mula daripada kerusakan nilai lokal itu sendiri.
So, when you're speaking about the local value, it's like it's a process that there are four aspects that form the community. The first one is the government, the second is the natural resources, the third is the society, and the fourth is the local values. What happens if people do not have, if the government, natural resources, and society do not have the value? They all become just robots. And speaking about the natural resources, it can be without value. It can be just an exploitation, because if you are speaking about government's policy, most of the government's policy just focus on the power, the interest that cannot be entirely trusted. That's why local value is very important here. And what is also as a vital aspect in local value is that the local value is embodied in the biodiversity of the land. So when the land is degraded or deteriorated, it is the moment where the degradation of local value began.
Question. Yeah, I want to ask Armin regarding the cosmology in the context of Salasa. How it's related to the belief of people in Salasa, and then its relation to be locally and strongly anchored on the soil of Salasa as an organic farmer. Thank you.
Kami anak-anak Salasa mengenal lumbung para itu sejak dari kecil. Ketika kami bisa melihat para secara fisik, seluruh keluarga kami itu melengkapi pandangan kami, penglihatan kami itu dengan cerita. Baik cerita fiksi mungkin maupun cerita nyata tentang proses dan nilai yang berkaitan dengan lumbung tersebut. Saya mengenal cerita soal lumbung itu dari nenek saya, yang menceritakan bagaimana tingginya posisi lumbung dan bagaimana ada makhluk-makhluk tertentu yang berupaya untuk bisa sampai ke lumbung. Yang pasti adalah bahwa cerita-cerita ini yang tertinggal kemudian tinggal cerita. Tapi nilai lumbung atau proses yang membekas di hati anak-anak Salasa itu masih ada sampai sekarang. Sehingga kemudian ketika ini ini diulang, dibangkitkan kembali, itu sungguh sama dengan menggali pengetahuan hal yang indah yang tersembunyi di pengalaman batin orang-orang Salasai. Sehingga kemudian ketika ini sekali lagi mau dibangkitkan untuk menjadi tujuan besar di masa depan, ini menjadi sesuatu yang mungkin ringan, mungkin membekas dan tampak bagaimana indahnya masa lalu, dan itu bisa ada di masa yang akan datang.
So we, the people of Salasai, mostly know the culture of Para since childhood. So most of the grandparents or parents enrich our point of view by the stories. It could be fiction or fact. We know the story of Lumung itself through a story that, through a traditional story that there are certain creatures that really want to try to reach the Lumung itself because it's located in between the roof and the ceiling. So there are certain stories like that. But what is left now is just the story, but the value is still exists. And when it's recalled, it's pretty similar to recall the memory or the beauty of the story within the people of the Salasai itself, which then it is pretty much, it may ease for people when want to organize people in organize our business story.
Nah, yeah. Saya ingin menambahkan sedikit. Misalnya di dalam pemuliaan padi atau pemuliaan tanam, perempuan-perempuan Salasai itu bisa memperlakukan tanaman itu ibarat seperti anaknya sendiri. Di masa-masa tertentu, di fase pertumbuhan tanaman padi, ada istilahnya kalau dalam bahasa Konjo, apa susu pare. Apa susu pare kalau dalam bahasa Indonesia mungkin adalah menyusui padi. Itu adalah satu tradisi, tradisi bagaimana orang-orang Salasai, terutama perempuan-perempuan Salasai itu, memuliakan sumber pangan. Dia menyusuinya dengan cara tertentu, menggabungkan antara gula dan santan, lalu kemudian dibawa ke sawah dan merendam malai terbanyak daripada padi itu sebagai sebuah proses menyusui, bagaimana masyarakat menyusui padinya atau tanaman padinya.
So I want to add something that seed breeding, the process of seed breeding, which a woman plays a very important role. So women treat the plant as their children, which in Konjo language mean apasupara, which is something like to give birth so the woman giving their breast to the padi, giving their milk from their breast to the padi as a kind of giving birth to the children. Children just born from to the world. So this is a process of want to add.
Jadi soal bagaimana cerita cerita dan perilaku, sebenarnya bagi kami dia saling berpengaruh, karena pesan moral, pesan leluhur itu sampai di kepala setiap orang Salasai, terutama di perempuan dan anak-anak generasi sekarang, itu diperhatikan, dan praktik ini juga. Itu juga kemudian berpengaruh pada cerita-cerita baru. Cerita baru dalam hal ini dia berujung menjadi semangat agar kemudian bisa diteruskan dari satu generasi ke generasi berikut.
So the story and the behavior which is interrelated one another, they are embodied and embedded in our memory to transform as a spirit to work collectively or working together.
Terima kasih.
Thank you.
Lovely. So if I understand you correctly, then it's the spirit of working collectively together has also a lot to do with respecting this kind of local knowledges, and as well as, well, with regards to respecting the local knowledge, it has to do with how do we preserve it. But at the same time, how do we also disseminate it? So I'm curious about this idea of both the preservation as well as the dissemination of this local knowledge in order for the local anchor, which is the primary value of the Lumbung to continue being active in a harmonious way. So it's almost like a harmonious entanglement of the local knowledge between its preservation as well as its dissemination. But I'm getting to a question. So Melanie, if you could please share with us this, you know, is it very much connected as well with the cultural identity, this idea of the Lumbung?
Okay. Thank you, Jumana. Well, I think Lumbung Initiative or Kampung Commoning is very closely related to identity. In my interaction with Kampung activists, I found that amongst the young people especially, there is this, inferiority complex about their status as originating from the rural area or the Kampung. The word kampung or village in Indonesian language has this connotation of being backward or outdated. With hyper-urbanization of the youth, the youth are not interested anymore in living in the village or working as a farmer. They consider their traditional culture and also their ethnic language not very cool. And they prefer urban lifestyle as they see in the internet or they listen to popular culture or consume this popular culture and social media. Now, the Lumbung or Kampung Cultural Commoning is trying to reverse this tendency by putting a very high value to traditional arts and culture. For example, I'll give an example of the kampung that I mentioned before in the kampung in East Java called the Dokombo. In that village, the Maduris language are considered to be not very cool according to young people because it's associated with poverty, with outdated, traditional, very, very old-fashioned, something like that. But the children club or the children association that they create, actually the company create, they use actually the Maduri's name, which is called Tanoker, which means the Maduri's word for cocoon, right? They decided to use that. And then they started to relearn traditional games and considered really put a high value by making it an international festival. Foreigners came and people coming to the village and then look at the children playing that traditional game and they really appreciate them. So these children finally see, they like our culture, you know? Our culture is considered important. They regain sort of a sense of pride about their language, for their cultural tradition, right? So, in that way, children started to relearn their identity as Maduris or their local traditional games and other. Well, this is still something that we need to bolster, meaning it's going all in all the various villages, trying to reactivate, they trying to tell again the stories of their ancestors in the Kampung heritage, and they try to make it modern for the young people, right? To make it relevant to their life. So this is an effort to regain sense of pride. In that way, the children will feel that it's fine to be ourselves. It's fine to have our own cultural identity and we are proud of it. So something like that. Yeah, thank you, Jumana.
Amazing to hear this, Melanie. I think it's It's wonderful to hear how the Lumbung practice is actually kind of upheld or nurtured through these, you know, through this way with the younger generation. Well, I'm sure that we're going to continue discussing this, and we're going to also address the questions we have from our audience after our 5-minute break. So we're going to take now a 5-minute break, and we will, when we return, address some of the questions that are being asked among our audience. Thank you, everyone, so much.
itu untuk kemudian hanya berkeinginan untuk mengeruk keuntungan sebesar-besarnya tanpa mempertimbangkan apapun yang terjadi di masyarakat. Nah, yang ironi adalah bahwa pengetahuan atau informasi dan penelitian yang berkaitan dengan kerusakan tanah ini hampir tidak pernah didengar, padahal dia muncul dari perguruan tinggi, dari universitas yang dibiayai oleh pemerintah sendiri. Tetapi pemerintah dalam artian dia mengabaikan pengetahuan-pengetahuan hasil penelitian tentang kerusakan itu. Nah, tapi mungkin bukan untuk menuntut siapa yang bertanggung jawab, tetapi di pemulihan tanah atau pemulihan lokal ini, pemulihan diri lokal, dia mesti menjadi gerakan sosial bagi seluruh masyarakat ini untuk kembali kepada titik pemulihannya. Karena kita tahu bahwa andaikan kekuatan seperti negara yang diharapkan untuk memulihkan sudah cukup waktu, sudah puluhan tahun waktu itu ditunggu, tapi hampir tidak pernah ada kebijakan yang untuk memulihkan seluruh daripada kerusakan tanah yang terjadi ini.
So soil in our local value, what I mean is not a metaphor, but it's a real sense which the local value lives above the soil and its condition. Speaking about responsibility of soil's degradation, mostly it comes from industry, but not at all, and the exploitative nature that are supported by the bureaucracy through its civil and military service, which then which has the principle to take benefit as much as possible from land. Ironically, there are many research on land degradation carried out here, but the government seems to not listen to them. They neglect it, by the way. And so the question about responsibility is not to us who is responsible, but what we can do to restore the soil. And because if we rely on the government, for many years back then, there's never been a real action to restore the degradation of soil.
Nah, saya tambahkan sedikit bahwa ini tidak terlepas dari soal kekuatan global, kekuatan globalisasi. Perusahaan antar negara yang kemudian dominasi kebijakan daripada negara-negara tertentu termasuk di Indonesia. Nah, proyek pertanian yang penuh dengan racun ini sekali lagi bukan hanya meracuni tanah, tetapi juga meracuni pikiran. Meracuni pemahaman sampai kemudian memproduksi pangan yang tidak sehat, di mana hampir seluruh konsumen tidak lagi punya kesempatan yang leluasa untuk mendapatkan produk pangan yang sehat. Implikasi lebih jauh adalah bahwa ini implikasi daripada revolusi hijau, yang lebih jauh adalah hilangnya kearifan lokal, hilangnya pengetahuan, dan sampai pada apa yang ditanyakan oleh saudara Charles tadi itu soal tanah yang lelah, tanah yang teracuni, dan yang bertanggung jawab sudah tadi bertanggung jawab ada industri, ada negara, tetapi untuk pemulihannya kita tidak bisa menyerahkan kepada mereka semua, harus melibatkan seluruh orang, baik petani maupun bukan petani, untuk terlibat mengkampanyekan atau terlibat langsung di dalam pemulihan ini.
So I want to add some things. The global power that aims to dominate the policy in agricultural industry seems to be there to have devastating impacts as well, because the chemical farmings that they proposed from many years ago, degrade the soil itself, but also poison our mind. Not just poisoning the land, but also poisoning our mind to have an access to healthy foods. And the implication of that is that again, like I said before, the degradation of local value is undeniable. And speaking about the responsibility is not. We cannot rely once again on industrial state to restore the soil condition. Is to involve the community in our local society.
I mean, to follow up on that question, that wonderful question by Charles Esche regards to the soil as a metaphor, do you believe that folklore tradition in Indonesia has in any way impacted agricultural practices?
Ya, baik. Cerita-cerita atau kisah-kisah lokal itu warnai dalam proses pemulihan atau penguatan komunitas petani maupun pertanian sendiri. Nah, di dalam pembangunan komunitas di Selasai, mulai dari tahap awal proses belajar bersama, cerita-cerita itu sangat dekat dan mewarnai teman-teman mengembangkan pertaniannya maupun mengembangkan organisasinya. Misalnya begini, dalam kasus misalnya untuk menghambat atau mengatasi hama-hama tanaman, teman-teman mengandalkan cerita-cerita masa dulu tentang obat-obatan di masa lampau yang digunakan oleh leluhur, oleh orang-orang tua, maupun dengan keyakinan itu berkomunikasi dengan dengan ulat maupun serangga yang dianggap pengganggu. Komunikasi yang disebut di sini bukan komunikasi dalam artian metafora. Dia benar-benar berkomunikasi dan yakin bahwa serangga ini bisa mengerti untuk kemudian tidak mengganggu tanaman mereka. Jadi cerita soal cerita di masa lalu dalam pengalaman di Selasai itu benar-benar mewarnai baik praktik pembangunan organisasi maupun di dalam praktik pertanian alami itu sendiri.
So the local of folklore in Selasai is really reverberate to us to restore the soil and to build the community. In Selasai, for example, the story that is very close to us, to the Kalubi organization, is very vibrant to make our practice alive. For example, to deal with the past, we rely on the story of the past. That is to communicate with them rather than to kill the past itself. This is not a metaphor, but the communication is understood in a real sense, communicating with the past. So instead of killing them, we provide the food necessary for the past itself. So through the communication with the past itself, worms, many others.
Thank you, Armin. Thank you, Harry. We have a question from Marwar Sanios to Milani. Thank you for the great presentations to both the speakers. I would like to know if there is a specific system. I would like to know if there is a specific system that has been developed and implemented through the years that fight against the asymmetric gender dynamics.
Thank you for the challenging question. Well, as we know, Indonesia is so diverse. We have hundreds of ethnic groups spread across the 70,000 islands. Each have their own tradition and each have different local patriarchies, forms of local patriarchies. In some areas, it's combined with, for example, the rise of religious conservatism that, of course, work to the not very well with the gender equality, right? So it's very varied, the gender dynamics in each localities. When I went to some urban kampungs, for example, some of the initiators of urban farmings are women. You know? They organize it. And they complain that the male are too lazy to be involved, right? In some other kampungs, it's the young people, mostly male. In other kampungs, it's mixed. So it's completely very varied, right? So we cannot generalize. However, when these kampung are connected to one another, then there is a very interesting dialogue usually occurring concerning women's participation. when one kampung who are very active with very active women participations commented on the others who are not, you know. So there in sharing the dialogues, then there is kind of a learning about gender, how to let women participate more in this and that. That's one thing. So the dynamics between the kampung themselves. Secondly, in the kampung, in initiating this lumbung activity, they are not working alone within their kampung, but they work with local governments, they work with the ministries, they work with universities, right? And there is one time I helped this Ministry of Village and Marginalized Areas to conduct the kampung commoning workshop and the lumbung activities, right? And in the requirement, we tell them that we want at least each kampung, there should be participation of women, something like that, you know, is the requirement. Universities also, then they work together, they initiate some gender mainstreaming agenda. But it's interesting to say that most of the cultural activists and kampung cultural activists, as they are working towards reactivation of traditional cultures, they are usually the progressive ones. They are not the one that is very narrow-minded in practicing their religion or things. So I find it interesting that these cultural activists, especially working in the arts and, you know, traditional cultures, are mostly progressive. And they really welcome women participation more. And some of them are very powerful women leaders also. So not really one systematic way. It's partial here and there, you know, it comes from different directions. And we are still facing a lot of challenges, especially of the rise of religious conservatism, right? But many women groups work about that too. For example, the Islamic women leaders with organizations like NU or Muhammadiyah, they also have their role in the villages working. I remember one time I went to a village in Kalimantan and there was this religious conservative groups coming trying to sort of occupy the village. And then these young leaders from the NU, which is the more traditional Islamic organization in Indonesia, they went to face this group, you know. So there are many bottom-up initiative, as well as initiative from different directions to make sure that there is at least more and more women are participating in this Lubung initiative. Thank you.
Yeah, I need to add, Melanie just said about the women leaders, they're coming from an organization called Nahdlatul Ulama, NU, Nahdlatul Ulama, or the moderate Islamic organization that has a long history in Indonesia. And also the next question is to both to Bu Melanie and also to Armin is that when was the first encounter? When was your first encounter with lumbung? Is it a thing when you were a child or exposed to when you very young? Or if it's one of the word that you learn from very young when you were a child, yeah.
He mentioned about his experience with lumbung when you know, children's experience with lumbung. Maybe he can answer it.
Ya, kami anak-anak salah saya termasuk saya sendiri itu berjumpa dengan lumbung itu dalam bentuk fisik di masa kecil. Seperti yang saya katakan tadi bahwa perjumpaan kami dengan lumbung secara fisik lengkap dengan cerita, lengkap dengan kisah yang disampaikan oleh orang-orang tua terhadap itu. Sekalipun awalnya secara fisik dia sebagai tempat menyimpan hasil panen, tetapi seluruh prosesnya anak-anak di kampung, anak-anak di Salas itu dilibatkan dalam proses seperti yang saya sebutkan tadi, mulai dari benih sampai kemudian naik di atas lumbung membawa atau mengambil hasil panen itu. Nah, cerita-cerita yang ada di seputar situ, jadi perkenalan orang-orang Salase maupun petani pada umumnya di Sulawesi dengan istilah baik para maupun rakyat, itu perkenalan dalam bentuk fisik dan seluruh nilai dan cerita yang ada di mana yang berkaitan dengan lumbung tersebut. Dan itu sekali lagi ada di seluruh, sekalipun secara fisik mungkin di banyak tempat sudah hilang, tetapi secara cerita maupun nilai itu berbekas di dalam kalbu orang-orang, baik orang Salasai maupun orang Sulawesi pada umumnya.
So we people in the Salasai at first recognize the lumbung in the form of its physicality, in the form of the building and so on, and it's coupled with the story and the value inside of the lumbung itself. So as I said before, children are involved. Children, many other people are also involved during the whole process of sowing the seed to harvesting the crops. Although para is no longer physically exists now, but the value is so memorable in our memories and also live within our memory, within our lives.
Okay, now I think it's my turn as a city child, right? Even I grew up in the city of in the small city of Malang, and of course not completely different from Pak Amin, who really grew up in the rural area with lumbung physically, you know, in front of them. I learned about lumbung from children textbook stories. And then later on, my teacher would take me to take us, the city children, to see the rice fields and also to see the lumbung, right? But unfortunately now, lumbung is disappearing physically. And today's generation, especially those living in the city, they only read it in textbooks and they cannot experience it like we do before. Therefore, I think there is the urgency to use lumbung and to revive it, you know. So it's not only as a physical entity, but the spirit behind it. And as Pak Armin already elaborated, the cosmology, philosophy, and Andan already also mentioned the values. So Lumbung Calling for me is an initiative to reverse this damaging force of hyper-urbanization, extractive industry, land grabbing, and urban consumerism that cause us to have a memory loss of our own culture, and that cause disappearing forests and rice fields, and also all the collective memory of the communities, and thus erasing their identity. So for me, Lumbung Calling is a call to again support this initiative of cultural collective regeneration, especially in my perspective, from the bottom up, from the kampung communities, urban as well as rural, for the future generation. Thank you.
Thank you, Melanie. Thank you, Armin, so much. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of depth in what I heard from both of you. There's a lot of, I guess, challenges and I think that we have a question from the audience with respect to the challenges. And the question is, how do you overcome prejudices within the Lumbung? So try to find it. Sorry. yes, how do you overcome prejudices in the Lumbung?
Yeah, there's a technicalities with Juana's connection. Yeah, this is to Bu Melanie. So how do you overcome prejudice in Lumbung? In most societies, there are exclusions because of racism, homophobia, or being afraid.
Yeah,
of
yeah. Also because of religious conservatism. I remember in one kampung, they tried to revive this myth of Dewi Sri, or, you know, all this myth of the goddess that protect, you know, harvest, etc. And there were some religious groups say that this is haram. I mean, this is not supposed to be done. So, but this kampung activist has a clear, clever idea of saying that, well, this is only the package, you know, beneath it, actually, what we are trying to do is to create the understanding of environment protection, how we really value the environment. So this ritual in the river or ritual in the agricultural field or rice field is not a religious ritual. It's a ritual in reviving our respect for nature, to protect nature from you know, pollution, from, you know, abuse, etc., like what Armin already mentioned. So there is this kind of negotiation, right, by this cultural activist against the one that is very religiously conservative, right? So there are many, many problems. Problems not only from the religious conservative groups, it can also from the capitals. You know, there is a story in also in Tegal about one mountain, karst, beautiful. The kampung is between these two karst mountains, very beautiful. But one mountain is already bought, taken over by one company. They took, they already excavated the mountain, and the mountain cannot be saved anymore. So finally, this active cultural activist working with the local government turned this other one, the one that's left, for mountain climbing. And for mountain climbing, and, you know, so this is turn it into a kind of a tourism, ecotourism. And that way they can save one mountain. So there are many, many challenges. There are, especially during the pandemic, there are other problems, you know. Those who live on ecotourism, for example, during the pandemic has to switch on to organic farming, to other creative ventures. There are also from political party sometimes, you know. So there are many, many other, many challenges. Joining the social media kampung network is one solution. When one kampung has a problem, other kampung offer strategies and some lesson learned from them, you know. So they could share knowledge together and supporting one another. So there, we are still facing a lot of problems, but what makes us hopeful is the energy and the spirit of this activism. There are a lot of problems. There are a lot of, sometimes they have to retreat one step in order to go forward. But I'm very happy to see how tough and how full of spirit these kampung activities are. Thank you.
I also want to add what Melanie mentioned, that even though some
the physicalities of a lumbung are already disappeared. But in some in some contexts in Indonesia, because Indonesia is a country with 17,000 and more 500 something islands, and there are many lumbung building which are still used by the communities where they belong to. For example, what I can mention is the people in the village of Salukanan, in Salukanan in Endreka, which are part of the Duri people. They still have this lumbung building called Landa, which can store the seed for more than 50 years. The same as with the lumbung in Ciptagelar, where they can store seeds for a long time. Yeah. Is it that the Documenta 15 team is planning to build up a lumbung community in Kassel? Thank you for the question, because also it's also one of the plan that we have from the beginning, that building lumbung will be started both from Kassel and also from Indonesia, and then the existing of Huru House. If you are in Kassel now and then you are passing by in front of Kassel, in front of Huru House, you will see the Huru House, which is one of the platform that we created since last year to start this Lumbung Kassel. And then we are working with some initiative in Kassel. Two of our friends, Reza Avicina and Iswanto Harsono, already been there since last year to work on this plan of building lumbung community in Kassel. And this is also part of the thing that we are discussing now, that because we believe the initiatives in Kassel are the ones who are locally anchored.
And so you'll connect with the initiatives in Kassel as local anchors for Documenta.
Yeah, of course. There are also already some events and programs which were developed by the team of Documenta 15, along with, as I mentioned, two of our friends, Reza Avicina and Iswanto Harsono, who are there. With two of our friends in Kassel also, Andrea Linenkohl and Aisha Gulech, who are also part of the artistic team.
Great, thank you, Amdan. We have a question for Armin. Besides the natural farming as a local anchor, is there any interlocal sharing or learning from the overseas activities?
Ya, jadi natural farming ini hanyalah salah satu bagian dari nilai lokal yang tumbuh dan diusahakan, diperjuangkan oleh teman-teman komunitas Salasai. Nah, nilai-nilai lokal yang inti kan kita mesti paham dulu apa dan nilai lokal atau nilai lokal seperti apa itu. Pertama adalah soal kepasrahan. Yang di paling ujung adalah soal pemujaan kepada pencipta, yang rentang waktunya bagi setiap individu adalah mulai dari ia lahir hingga ia mati. Dan di dalam kehidupannya ada musyawarah, ada gotong royong, ada perundungan, dan ada penghargaan, ada penghormatan atau pemujaan. Nah, pertanyaan alami hanyalah salah satu nilai, adalah hanya salah satu praktek yang diambil atau berangkat dari nilai lokal. Praktik-praktik lainnya adalah soal bagaimana ia membangun organisasi, bahwa situasi sekarang orang mengambil paham pentingnya organisasi, tetapi organisasi yang kami bangun, teman-teman petani bangun adalah benar-benar organisasi yang tidak ada jarak dengan dirinya, tidak ada jarak dengan pengetahuan dan pengalamannya. Organisasi itu adalah dirinya sendiri, tidak menjadi sesuatu yang asing. Begitu pula dengan pengembangan partisipasi, perlibatan kelompok-kelompok perempuan, anak-anak dan lain-lain, serta kemudian partisipasi atau keterlibatan komunitas dalam pengambilan keputusan di desa itu berangkat dari upaya-upaya yang dari nilai yang dipahami dan berkembang di desa. Jadi sekali lagi bukan hanya pada secara teknis pertanian alami, tapi di seluruh nilai, di seluruh kehidupan bermasyarakat mestinya memang berasal dari nilai-nilai kalian di sana.
So there are many natural farming is just one part of local value that live in society. Many other there are many local values in Selesai itself. One of the practice is when we practicing and build the organization. So in the organization, there is no gap between the people within, with the knowledge the farmers have, with the experience, and with the selves as well. So there's no gap between them. And also in organization, there is a participation of women and children. All of them are started from the local value. And one typical example also in decision making, so which is highly embodied from our local value. So we don't have voting in the elections. So we want to make decisions always from assembly. Assembly, and no voting until the conclusion is reached. So that's one of the manifestation of value in decision making.
The question coming from Ina Nasir, which is called, he said that, I have to convey, he said that, what image do we have mentioning God? This is very interesting because maybe we can Armin Salasa can share his stories on the concept of God in the cosmology of people in Salasa. Thank you.
Tidak seperti yang saya sampaikan tadi bahwa ketika nilai lokal yang bicara secara totalitas itu ada rentang waktu antara lahir dan mati, dan pada titik manusianya itu adalah pada titik terendah, artinya menerima dirinya apa adanya dan pengakuan pada seluruh kekuasaan atau ciptaan dari Yang Maha Kuasa. Nah, ketika kita bicara Tuhan, apa yang terbayang? Yang terbayang adalah soal proses kita, adalah kepasaran kita, penerimaan apapun yang terjadi. Dalam hal ini adalah pasrah. Jadi yang muncul itu bukanlah bentuk, bukan gambar, tetapi adalah soal keyakinan dan pasrahan. Nah, ini yang kemudian terbawa di dalam kehidupan keluarga tani, di dalam perilakunya, baik hubungannya di dalam keluarga, kemudian di dalam urusan dengan air maupun tanah maupun dengan tanaman.
So when we're speaking about the God in local values, so as I mentioned before, so from the birth to death, from recognizing God to the submissive behavior, it's all like a cycle, like a whole process. But the very important point is that our submissiveness and our acceptance to the God. So when we're speaking about God, it's not about image, but the beliefs that we put in him, that is reflected in behavior of people in Selesai. So when we talk about God, we do not talk about image, but we talk about the beliefs that we have.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone, for your time. I would like to thank our guest, Ibu Melanie Budianta and Armin Salasa, So Armin Salasa translator Hari Isra, who they are sitting in Makassar, and Bu Melanie is sitting in Jakarta, and also to Jumana Emil Abud for hosting also this first session of Lumbung Calling. Jumana is sitting in Jerusalem, as well as a special thank to Undin Shaver, who has been interpreting in international sign language. I would like to thank to all of you for your attention and for asking such relevant questions and comments. Please note, in case you have missed some parts of, or if you like to share this video, it will be online very soon. Save the date for the next Lumbung Calling in May 1st. Be safe and stay healthy. Thanks so much.
Tahun 2000, tahun harapan yang penuh tantangan dan mencari